If you want to turn to Exodus 23, we're going to start in verse 20. We said a couple weeks ago that this whole Exodus, the whole account of Exodus, is like this incredible visual of the New Testament covenant that came in Jesus Christ and God's deliverance and God's salvation for the Israelites and him promising to never leave them, to being with them. Even now today, we struggle in our temptations as believers, but we know that God hasn't left and God will not leave us. It's an incredible visual that's laid out here in Exodus in correlation with the new covenant that we find in Jesus Christ on earth today, alive in believers, our hope, the hope that we have of eternity with him. That many of the promises we see God speak to his people in Israel are the same promises that are true today for us that God has spoken to us. His word endures through it all. From what is from ancient times to what is present, his word for us endures through it all. He never fails. So we're going to kind of see an account here in Exodus 23 of God's relationship and desire to be their God and have a relationship with them. And that's one of the things I think, you know, when you look at the world today, people view God as distant. As yes, there may be a God up there somewhere, and there's probably many ways to him. These thoughts, these ideologies, these philosophies that mankind have kind of that bubbled up within their hearts have really distracted them from the one true God who absolutely desires a relationship with his creation. In fact, he's called jealous within it. Like, that's his name, capital J, I am jealous. He desires a relationship with his creation deeply, and he desires a relationship with Israel here. And just as he desired you, he came to you through his son, chose you so that you can know him and be fully known by him within your life here and for all eternity. That is God's heart for mankind. And the light of the gospel in Jesus Christ, the blood shed on the cross and his resurrection, is the truth to that. It testifies to the fact that God so loved us so much that he desired that relationship. And it's the same here with the Israelites. He doesn't change. He's not different in the Old Testament than the New Testament. He's the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He will always have the same character and nature this time in Exodus 23 and in these present times. God desires to save in a relationship with his children, a deep one, a deep relationship. Exodus 23, verse 20 says this. See, I'm sending an angel ahead of you to guard you along the way. We're going to read the whole passage here. And to bring you to a place I have prepared. Pay attention to him and listen to what he says. This is God speaking to the Israelites. Do not rebel against him. He will not forgive your rebellion since my name is in him. If you listen carefully to what he says and do all that I say, I will be an enemy to your enemies and will oppose those who oppose you. My angel will go ahead of you and bring you into the land of the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and I will wipe them out. Do not bow down before their gods, hold on to that, or worship them or follow their practices. You must demolish them and break their sacred stones to pieces. Worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be on your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. Do you see what God is doing for his people? I'm going to do all the work. That's how God works. Yesterday, today, how are you saved? God did the work. Why? Because he willed it first. How do we love God? Only because God loved us first. You see the same nature of God unfolding in the Old Testament as you do in present time. God always leads the way to himself. God always leads the way to fulfilling his word. He uses us in a sense, but it's only by his power in which he accomplishes his promises. That's it. I will turn your enemies back and they will run. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, Canaanites, and Hittites out of your way, but I will not drive them out in a single year because the land would become desolate and the wild animals too numerous for you. Little by little, I will drive them out before you until you have increased enough to take possession of the land. And that land is Canaan, the promised land that God has promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all of Israel. I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea and from the desert to the Euphrates River. I will give into your hands the people who live in the land and you will drive them out before you. And do not make a covenant with them or with their gods. This is the second time he's come back to this. Do not assimilate to their gods. Do not assimilate to their patterns. Do not let them live in your land or they will cause you to sin against me. Because they worship their gods, they will certainly ensnare you. So you have God's heart, you have God's will. He's given these directives and commands about what not to do. Do not assimilate and do not follow their gods. Do not bow down to what they worship, the ones they worship. Do not become like them in their ways. And when we read Exodus 23, we see the commands and promises of God that he gives to his people, that he will fulfill his promise. He will fulfill what he has promised. But within those, that fulfillment and within what God will do, he also says, look, worship me alone within it. I'm going to accomplish my will. I will do it all. But don't worship what the world around you is going to worship. We know that God's word will never fail, that he will always accomplish what he has spoken. And 600 years prior to this moment, this is beginning to be the fulfillment of the word he spoke to Abraham 600 years ago. That's sometimes we want God to work in our time, right? Like, you know, I pray and then I wish it would happen tomorrow, or I wish that life would just kind of change like quickly, like it's kind of a rough valley season. Well, sometimes that valley can be a week, and sometimes that valley can be 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. But within it all, God's not done. He hasn't left us. And that's what we see here. 600 years before, he said, Abraham, I'm going to make your descendants as numerous as the dust. I'm going to give you so many offspring, and they're going to be my chosen people, and I'm going to take you into the promised land. 600 years before this, God has not forgotten his promises, nor has he failed in those words. He's going to fulfill them in his time. Genesis 12:7, this is what he says to Abram before he becomes Abraham. The Lord said to Abram, to your offspring I will give this land. This land is the way in which God is preparing his people to go. He's getting rid of the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Canaanites. He is preparing them. He is going to push them out so that Israel can fulfill what God has spoken. He is going to do the work to fulfill his word. He is going to push them aside, work on behalf of the Israelites so that they can go into the land he promised Abram, one man, 600 years ago. He will fulfill his word. He's perfect in fulfilling his word. And what we see God doing within those commands and promises, as he promises to be faithful to his word, as he says, I'm going to give you this land, and he will accomplish his purpose. He has an inability to fail, which is not a character of mankind, right? He has an inability. He cannot fail. There is not a person on earth that you could look at, that you could depend wholeheartedly on in this earth. I don't care if it's a husband or a wife or a friend or a leader of this sort or that sort or whatever it may be. There is not a person on earth that can claim that. There is only one being, and that is the one true God, Yahweh, who they are following, that is incapable of failing. He cannot fail because he's God. If he were to fail, then he wouldn't be God. He is incapable of failing his word. That's who he is versus the fragility of mankind, the inability of mankind. And that's why he says to the Israelites, don't worship what's going to fail you. Don't follow their patterns of what's going to destroy you. He says, look to me. He knows who he is. God knows who he is, and he knows what the Israelites need, and he knows that the Israelites primarily and mostly need him to accomplish his will through them. That's the same for us in Jesus Christ. That's the same for us in Jesus Christ today. He hasn't changed. We need him to accomplish his purpose and will through us. What did Jesus do when he was on here on earth? You think he just did it by himself? It says he often went away to pray. Jesus knew that he needed the Father to accomplish, even as the Son of God, that he needed the Father to depend on the Father, his strength within him, to carry out God's will within his life in those 33 years that he lived. So too do we need that today. That's so true for us today. He is faithful to his word, and his people can have peace within his power. That's what God is saying. This, I'm going to do it all. There's no way mankind can stand up against me. I will clear the way for you to make it to the land. There's peace within his power that we have. He cannot fail his words, and that is our peace on earth. He cannot fail the promises he's made to you, that we memorize, that we read, Old Testament, New Testament. He cannot fail. That is our peace on earth. He confronts this issue of them trying to, and then the possibility of them being kind of bent to following other gods and looking at the patterns of the nations that they would confront and begin to worship the gods that they might be in. And he says this, I'm just going to read a couple of these verses here in Exodus 23. He says this about them. Do not bow down to their gods or worship them or follow their practices. He goes on to say in verse 32 of this same chapter, do not make a covenant with them or with their gods. So as my people, do not follow them. Do not practice what they practice. Do not make a covenant with their people. Do not let them even live in your land. This is God's love toward his children. He knows their fallenness, their sinful nature, to look around and with their eyes see what could be great, or what do these people depend on that they can see or make with their hands, when God said, look, you have to listen to my word. My word is the only thing that's eternal. Everything else withers and falls like the grass of the field. Even the people you see, they will wither and fall, and they will be forgotten in generations to come. God is eternal alone. But the temptation for God's people was to live like the world around them. Isn't that not true for us today as the body of Christ? Is that not the same temptation that we have today? It's to watch the world around us and say, well, they have that. They go after that. And I'm telling you, there are so many people that have grown up in the church that have found a better taste in what is of the world than of what they've known or been told of Jesus Christ as they grew up. And now what we pray for is those seeds that were planted to come to fruition as they've wandered away to the world. That's the story of so many people that have grown up even in the church. It's a testimony of people. They've tasted of God, but then within that, there's this longing to become like the world because the world has offered something that satisfies the fleshly nature. It could be government, it could be money, it could be this person or that person or a relationship, and then you begin to wander in, and what takes the place of Christ and God is that thing, the love of this rather than the love of a Savior, rather than the love of God. He knows their hearts. He knew they were vulnerable to conforming to the pattern of the people that they would confront, that he would bring them in front of and defeat because they're sinful like you and me. And it's God's truth for us today as well. As his chosen children, he's given us his spirit to teach us and guide us. That's why we have conviction when we know we're doing something wrong, because God loves us. He reminds us of what he said in the word. He reminds us of, like, you know what I've said. You ever been in those times when you know you've been doing something wrong, or you've spoken something wrong, you've done something wrong, and immediately there's a conviction that settles in because the Spirit of God is alive in you. He lives in you. God himself lives in us to hold us and keep us to him, so that even in the wandering, we still have him speaking to us that we would come back. We still have him speaking to us that we're held to him, that we would respond to that, that the Spirit speaking to us saying, stop, leave those ways, turn around from your sin. It's destructive. It may seem very pleasant at the moment, but it's destructive. And we have the scripture that he brings to mind. That's the role of the Word of God. That's the role of the Spirit, to remind us of what Jesus Christ said, even in those temptations today. And the reality of us today is it's the same. We don't necessarily fight like they did for land. Back then it was different. I mean, I always think about, how do these people fight with swords? Like, I've always been a little, like, weird. Like, how does a dude just pick up a sword and go out and fight and stab people? Like, anybody have that weird thought? Like, I mean, it's just so different back then. It's just so brutal and gruesome. And yes, it's still that way in which today, and there's even rumors of war today, correct? Russia, Ukraine, and all these things where, man, you just see the world in its sinful ways begin to destroy itself as it has for all eternity, or all, since the beginning. And you have these moments where you're watching the world go within these ways, but you realize that within your own heart, that there's different spiritual struggles, because that's what we battle with as believers. Our battle is not flesh and blood anymore. The world battles flesh and blood. It's an argument to be won. It's a war to be won. It's how can I make my life better for this moment, this temporary moment while I'm alive. Our battle is not with an enemy for land. Our battle is a spiritual battle, and actually all battles within this earth have a spiritual origin within it. Pride? How do you think Russia's lined up at Ukraine? That's pride issues. That's power struggles. That's evil. That's how that happens. It's not because, hey, let's take land. The origin of all those things is sin. Just like we know within our heart where our battle is. We may not be facing Jebusites and Canaanites, but we face a bigger enemy, and God knows that for us. And he's given us, just as he gave the Israelites in this time, a way to fight, a way to protect and guard ourselves. And that enemy we know is Satan himself. If you read Ephesians 6:10-16, this is what God has spoken to us. He says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Right now, Israel is fighting a man, fighting nations, fighting man. We have an enemy that is against us spiritually. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. That's the battle we fight, you guys. That's the battle we fight. It is spiritual. All around us, within us, outside of us, in the city, the issues that we fight are spiritual, and they must be confronted spiritually, which God says, look, it's in prayer. It's in the way you love me. It's in the way you love your neighbor. It's in prayer. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of the evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. We need his truth, his promises. With the breastplate of righteousness in place and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace, he is pointing to himself in all these things. You need me. You need my word because I'm unfailing, and that's how you're going to fight the enemy that is against you now in this day as a child of God. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, the certainty of who God is, the certainty of what you believe, the certainty of his ability to fulfill every word. That's what you're going to fight with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, those temptations that come your way to become like the world around you, or as the Israelites are warned, to become like the Canaanites, to become like the Hebusites, the Jebusites, the Amorites. Ours are the temptation the same today, to become like the world around us and what we see and what is tempted of the flesh to say, just go this way. Look how happy those people are. Look how happy the world is. Look how much more fitting and tolerable it is just to fit in, just to do what they do, to take on the ideologies or truths of the world around us and to live in those ways. When God says no, like discern these things through the word, discern what's happening spiritually around you through the word of God. Let him speak to you and guide you, even within those temptations to fall into those ways. Like, look, here's just one example. In the body of Christ, what the world has told us as the body of Christ and as young believers, and I've heard it, is that marital relations or sexual relations before marriage are acceptable. Why? Because the world does it. Why? Well, you're out of touch if you believe that. I've heard that from Christian kids. I've heard that. That is exactly what we're talking about. The world does it, therefore I can do it, but yes, I still love Jesus. I'm sure you do, but understand this. What we are and within those thoughts is absolutely deceived. Because what those things are destructive spiritually. There's a wandering that happens. There's a hindrance to the fellowship that we have with God. But you see the tiny creep in of, well, everybody else does it, so I guess I'll just do it too. Yeah, I'm a Christian, but look, the whole world does it. You are peculiar people. You're strange, and you should be a little bit different and unique, myself included. It should be a little awkward in the way that we live around the world. You don't do those things? Why don't you do those things? And then the answer is because I love God. Well, you may get persecuted for that one, but guess what? If you're persecuted, blessed are you because yours is the kingdom of heaven. I mean, this is a difficult road to walk sometimes, following Jesus and not following into the world. To just say look, we are set apart in Christ. We have been chosen by him just as the Israelites. And our love for God is shown in the way that we obey him. That's why he says, listen to the angel. Listen to what he says. Do as I say. And so we have these issues that's just one issue within our culture today. That's one issue within our culture today where the body of Christ is continually a little bit creeping over into the ways of the culture and people around us. God loves them. In fact, he saved us for a purpose of being the light to them so that they may know truth within their darkness that would save them from it. But at the same time, he's called us not to follow the ways of the world. And so here God speaks to us today. Listen to me, right? Know him, know my truth. Hold to my promises in faith. Believing what I've said has authority over all. It's the same thing that God is saying to the Israelites here in Exodus 23. Do not conform. Listen to my words. Follow me. Don't worship other gods. Worship me. I'm going to fulfill every word I've promised through you and for you. He's going to do what he says. And we are in a time when God's truth, the one true God, not this like illogical truth, many truths and just choose one as long as you're happy with it. That's so messed up. That is so from the devil. It's just a personal thought of how I feel and how this one thing makes me feel. And if this one truth doesn't work, I'll just find another truth. It's exactly the game that Satan wants this world to play. There is one God, one truth. He's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he loves the world so much that he crushed his son on a cross. That he did all the work for you to know him. He did all the work in preparing the way to a promised land and inheritance eternally. He did all the work through his son. We didn't do anything. That's the only message that saves. And when we read those things, that we read these scriptures that, look, God does all that he pleases. It's true. And he pleased him to crush his son on the cross. Even if in the agony of the Garden of Gethsemane, that Jesus sat there sweating blood from this immense amount of stress, that he said, your will be done. Take this cup from me, Lord, but your will be done. If that's your will, I'm going to do it. Because he loved the Father. And 800 years after God speaks to Moses in Exodus, we're reminded again of the Israelites' struggle, like they did. If you know it, you know they come from Jacob. Jacob literally means wrestle with God. And if you want to know the definition of the Israelite existence, it's wrestling with God constantly. And 800 years after God speaks to Moses here, that I will always fulfill what I do. I will deliver you. I will be faithful to my word. I will say, I will speak, and then I will fulfill what I speak and I desire. 800 years after this, there's a prophet Isaiah that God calls to the Israelites, and he says this about his character and nature within the comparison of what the world worships. Listen to what he says in Isaiah 46, 3 through 10. Within the struggle of Israel. Listen to me. It's the exact same thing that God spoke to the Israelites in Exodus. Listen to him. Listen to me. Do what I say. Listen to me. I have what's good for you. 3 through 10, listen to me, you descendants of Jacob, Israel, all the remnant of the people of Israel, you whom I have upheld since your birth and have carried since you were born. Do you see God's intimate acquaintance with his people? He's known them since their birth. He's carried them and called them children since their birth. Even to your old age and gray hairs, I am he. I am he who will sustain you. I have made you and I will carry you. I will sustain you and I will rescue you, which he has done over and over in the Old Testament as of this point. With whom will you compare me or count me equal? That's the question that we need to have settled in our mind. That is the question that we have to have settled in our mind. Who are you going to compare God to in your life? Because if we compare God to something else, then we are making that thing or that person God. He is not comparable to anything that we could ever find on earth. You want to know why? Because you can have a relationship, a beautiful blessing of a relationship, a wife, a husband. You can have all the money in the world. You can have the fame, the followers. You can have all the athletic ability, whatever you want. The problem is this, is that you still have to deal with death and sin. That's the issue. None of that you're taking with you, and none of that saves you from the inevitability of what's coming because of sin for all of our lives, which is death. Who are you going to compare God to? He's the only one that can save. Do you want the momentary pleasure of earth, the gods of the earth that the earth worships, or do you want the eternal Savior? That's the offering of Jesus Christ. Who are you going to compare me equal? To whom will you liken me that we may be compared? Who are you going to compare me to? God knows this about himself. Do we know this about him within our hearts and our minds and how we live? Some pour out gold from their bag and weigh out silver on the scales. They hire goldsmith to make it into a god, and they bow down and worship it. They lift it to their shoulders and carry it. They set it up in its place, and there it stands. From that spot, it cannot move. He's speaking about the gods of these people that the Israelites would confront. They're just stones. They're just momentary. They don't do anything. They don't hear you. From that spot, it cannot move. Even though someone cries out to it, it cannot answer. It cannot save them from their troubles. And I'm telling you, you cannot cry out to money. You cannot cry out to medicine. You cannot cry out to a person to save you. Only God can save. He's the only one that has the power to save. And eventually all these other things that the world would offer us as the body of Christ, they're going to fade away. They're going to reveal themselves as incapable of fulfilling what we hoped they were. They're not. We are thankful, but they are not God, and they are not worthy of our life or our love eternally. And he goes on, he ends this in Isaiah 46. Remember this, keep it in mind. Isn't that awesome that even in the Old Testament they're saying, remember the words of God. What's the Holy Spirit's role? To remind us what the word of God is. Take it to heart, you rebels. Remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, he says. And there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say my purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please. That's our God. And this is the challenge to the Israelites now within the struggle of sin to say, who's God? Who are they going to compare him to? Because there's going to be moments when they shine. And there's going to be moments in throughout the whole entire Old Testament where they turn away. And God has to remind them again, and he does so here with Isaiah the prophet. And as a believer, his word is our hope. His word keeps us and guides us because he is always perfect and faithful to it. And that is why he begins this passage with saying, listen to him and do what I say. He knows where peace is truly found. Like, God knows where peace is truly found for his people, the Israelites and us today. It's in him alone. And where are we with that within our own lives? How much do we really cherish his word and his promises and who he is as God? They correlate with each other. Like, look, if we treasure Christ, his word is everything to us. If we treasure Christ, then his word is the utmost important. There is no other word or thought or idea or movement that shakes us from what we cherish most. If we treasure the world and its ways that are apart from him, then we treasure that what cannot last. It'll be taken, it'll be gone, it'll be shakable. It's a peace that is not like the peace of Christ. It can be moved immediately and taken from us. And the human heart, just pay attention to what goes on in the world and the people around you. The human heart longs for eternal. That is why romance movies are so darn, people love them, because they want love like that. They want a love that is just so encompassing, yet that love even goes away. Someone's dying within that relationship in that movie. It's not eternal. We have a God that loves us so much more than that silliness. So much more in a sacrificial way, where he would give himself so that we could be with him, and we've done nothing to earn that. You can look around at our whole world today and you can see people desperate for peace, desperate for joy. You know how mad people are right now because of COVID? I mean, people are just mad. I mean, around, there's a shortness to people, and there's a frustration around it. The joy of what was normal is gone. Hopefully we'll get that back. If that's our hope as the body of Christ, then, man, that's just a weird hope to have, because you're still hoping in something that's fading away. I mean, it's always shakable. Like, look, wouldn't it be awesome if we had 5 years of relief from all this? But guess what? 5 years from now, it could be worse. We don't know. That's the reality of the world. And that is the hope of Jesus Christ that we have that's eternal. He is not like the world. And he says, worship me alone. This is our God. This is our God. He's not like that. We can't compare anything that we could ever have or hope for in this world to the hope that we have in his word, that he's faithful to it forever. His promises from the beginning and now are always yes. If you read 2 Corinthians 1, 20 through 22, it says this, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. Go ahead and name a verse that you like. One of my favorite verses, there's nothing that can separate you from the love of Jesus, from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ. Romans 8. That is yes and amen, and it will not be, and it cannot be overcome. Why? Because God spoke it, and he is perfectly faithful to his word, that he will always love me and that he has saved me eternally. Even when I sin, he loves me. There's forgiveness, and there's a calling to repentance in those things, at moments. But it's because he loves me. I cannot be separated from that love that's eternal because of what he's done through his son. That's a yes and amen promise. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. Now it is God who makes, listen to this, now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. So God makes us, he gives us the strength to stand firm. It is only by God's power, the Spirit he's given us, that we can stand firm in him. Not on our own effort. Isn't that awesome? That not only did he save you out of his own effort, but then he gives you the strength to stand firm within this world that may try to ensnare us, or the Satan may try to ensnare us, he gives us the strength to stand firm in it. Saved us and the strength to stand firm. It's God's work. And it's an amazing thing to watch him at work within a person. He is worthy of our trust in our lives because he is always faithful to it. One of the first words that he speaks of in this, and then we're closing in Exodus 23, is guard. He's going to guard you. It's a promise of never being left alone, you guys. I know that there's times when it's lonely. I know there's times when there may be doubt that creeps into our mind, and there may be things that we've done that where we feel farther from the Lord, but that's not the reality of Christ. You may feel farther from the Lord, or your heart may condemn you in a way, but that's not the reality within God. He's a father. He's a father to his children. and the God to Israel through all things until he says the promise is fulfilled. I'm going to guard you until the promise is fulfilled. That was an inheritance of a promised physical land to them 600 years before that was spoken to them through Abram. It's now being fulfilled. This land is going to happen. And he's going to guard them until they take that land. And we're going to close with 1 Peter thinking of that. Listen to this. 2:3-5. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He did all the work. And into an inheritance, not land, not a physical earthly land, but into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. That is a promise in which we want yes and amen. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. It is kept in heaven for you by the power of God. Nothing more or less that you're going to do to earn it back or earn it or gain it. It is only held for you by his power and who he is. Who through faith in him, we have a belief and faith in him, are shielded, guarded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time that we would take our inheritance. And that is what we're going for. That is the journey of the Israelites to the inherited land. That is our journey and our hope of inheritance eternally with God himself. That's our inheritance. And he guards us and keeps us within all. And it's the same thing. What does he speak to us? Within this, guard your heart. Be aware of the schemes around you. Don't follow the world. And the word of God is there for our protection, our warning, our encouragement, our restoration. This is God doing the whole work through you so that he will keep you and then give you the inheritance that he's brought to you through his son. What have you done? All he says is follow me. And I know it's not easy at times. And if you've strayed, if you've wandered within those things, thank God for forgiveness. I mean, that's what grace is for. That is the gospel that God knows that we still have sin. We still struggle with sin, but that the blood of Christ speaks a word that is eternal over us of our innocence before the Father continually, at all times, eternally. Because he loves us so much. Where is your trust? What do you hope in? What do I hope in? Where's your trust at? How truly great are the things of this world in comparison to an unfailing God? They're good. I enjoy them. I always wanted a motorcycle. I mean, someday maybe I want a motorcycle. I'm kind of waiting for my kids to get older. I mean, they're nice. I like them. I mean, it's cool. I mean, money, okay, great. I mean, all these things that we could search after, you guys. Thank God for relationships and people that love us deeply. But without God, it's a blip and they're gone. And then the same ending is the same. We have to face a judge, an eternal authority sovereign over every single person on earth. And we're judged under, as believers, we're judged in his blood. We have forgiveness because of what he's done. It speaks for us. He speaks for us out of our innocence and our forgiveness, our righteousness. We are the righteousness of Jesus Christ because of him. He's loved us that much. Who are you going to compare to that? I mean, I'm thankful for all of you. You guys are, I mean, I love you guys. But man, without God, what are we doing? I mean, someday, here's the awesome thing. Someday, we're all just going to simply not have to deal with sin together. I don't even know what that looks like. I don't even know if you're going to have people teaching you. I don't even know if people are going to teach me. We're just going to have the fullness of God somehow, some way, in a place that is absolutely, there's no sorrow, there's no pain, there's no sin. And that is our eternity. Not 90, 100, 150 years, forever. This is our God. Who are you going to compare him to on earth? Think about that. That's what God's trying to tell the Israelites. What are you going to follow their ways? We're trying to protect you from those things. This is a loving God that loves us. So where is your trust? Is it in what the world has or has their hope in around us? Or is it truly in his loving, unfailing, perfect word and will through his Savior, Jesus Christ, for us? I mean, he loves us so much. It's unmeasurable. It's unfathomable. And he loves you deeply today. And I hope you guys hear that. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for a chance to be here. Thank you for your word. God, may you just continue to protect us from the evil one. Just as you taught us to pray. God, I thank you so much for the spirit that you've given us, Holy Spirit. Just continue to make us ready for our heavenly home here while we live. May we just grow in your word. May we grow in our faith. Lord, may you just continue to transform our hearts and our minds to be more like your Son. God, we love you so much, and thank you for all that you've done, and protect us, God, and forgive us our sins. Now we know that you're faithful in all those things. It's in your name we pray. Amen.